Welcome to Team Pegine's CD message. Pegine Echevarria is founder of Team Pegine, a multifaceted human potential company that focuses on leadership, success, and team building. Listen as she shares her thoughts on the power of choice.
When I was 17, I knew I needed to get out of where I was. You see, I grew up in an area that was, it was an area that was filled with different kinds of gangs. There were people that used to just hang out and were just slimy. I mean, just some slimy people. And more importantly is, as I was looking around me, I knew I didn't want to be around here. I didn't want to be around them. I knew that if I stayed here any longer, I would be in trouble, big time trouble, because I was starting to hang out with the wrong people at the wrong time, and soon luck wouldn't be with me. Where I grew up, there were just lots of people that were into drugs, into gangs, all involved with stuff. I really didn't realize how bad it was until I started venturing out there in the world and seeing different places and saying, there's a whole new world out there that I have to expose myself to. So, I walked home from hanging out on the corner, went downstairs to my basement, took six countries and wrote the names and put them in a hat. Wrote their names on a piece of paper and put it inside a hat. I closed my eyes and I prayed and I just said, please send me to the country that will make me strong, make me better, make me learn. I closed my eyes, put my hand in the hat, and picked out a piece of paper. The paper said boldly, Spain. And with that, I knew where I was headed and where I was going to live for the next few years. I ran up the stairs and I went to my mom. Guess what? I'm going to Spain. She said, no, you're not. I said, yes, I am. I'm going to Spain. And she looked at me and said, no, you're not. I said, yes, I am, Ma, so you might as well just get used to it. She did, because she definitely knew me that I can get very pig-headed. About 2 months later, I boarded a plane and went to Spain, and it was one of the best choices that I ever, ever made in my life. This time, I want you to make and understand your choices. To understand that every aspect of your life is run by your power of choice. If you work in an environment that's toxic and feel like your life energy is being drained, but you believe that you have to stay there because of the security it offers, then you need to know that you do have control through the power of choice. You have the ability to change your environment by thinking differently, acting differently, and living differently. Even though I choose at that moment in my life to flee and go someplace else, it was through choice and understanding that I had a choice about the kind of life that I had and the kind of life that I wanted. To this day, we all have choices. For instance, if you're constantly suffering because you can't meet your financial obligations, you do have the power of choice to either continue living as an under-earner or develop the skills to be a six-figure earner. It's really up to you, because it is about your choice. Choosing the kind of career that you take, choosing the steps that you take to meet your goals. I have to say that every morning we each have a choice. And sometimes we avoid looking at them because we don't think that they're important, or that we choose different strategies that don't help us. When you get up in the morning, how do you look at your life? How do you choose to look at your life? As you go downstairs or down the hall, do you choose to have a glass of water, or do you choose something else? Do you choose to say to the person that you're living with, I love you, or do you choose to look at them in disdain? How you choose to act is everything about your power. Your power to control the situations. And when you think that you can't, understand that you are choosing to think that you can't change, that you can't do something different, that you can't live life differently. I think every single person in this world struggles, knows, and challenges themselves about the choices that we make. Of course, sometimes it's a lot easier to choose what looks like the simpler and easier way that our minds tell us is simpler and easier. I mean, I know for myself, it is always easier not to exercise than to exercise. Although when I really look at the choices and I see that not exercising is in the long run going to give me a body that just drives me nuts and makes me feel sluggish. And that exercising, even though it feels like it's a lot of work, and even though I do feel sore, and even though I do feel frustrated, in the long time would give me the body, or at least the energy, that I dream of. I know that for myself, and I struggle with it all the time. So I'm not saying that understanding the power of choice... I am saying that understanding the power of choice is easy. I'm not saying that implementing the power of choice is easy. Because sometimes the choices that are good for us are the harder ones to make and live up to. So during this session, one of the things that we're going to be talking about, well, a bunch of things that we're going to be talking about is, how do you choose your attitude? How do you accept responsibility for the power of your choice? How do you choose to be energetic and have energy? How do you choose to commit to yourself of what you're going to do? And how do you know what you want? How do you figure that out so that you can choose the life you have from others, from your work, for your family, and for yourself? I'm looking forward to talking with you about this because choice is powerful for both you and for me. You know, one of the hardest parts about living is accepting responsibility, about understanding that we are responsible for the quality of our life. I think the hardest part for me when my kids were small and I was going to school at night, working during the day, leaving the family, and trying to manage every little detail and be the perfect mom and be the perfect wife and be the perfect everything, I found myself not making the best choices for me and for the life I wanted to live. I did want to get my degree, and I loved what I did at work, and I loved my family. But I wasn't really paying attention to what I was choosing for my own body and for my own health. What I had done was find myself running from here and running to there and trying to do this and trying to do that and never giving myself a chance to just have downtime and relax. At that time, I was working with drug-addicted women and children and helping them get over drugs and at the same time develop a career in sales and be a direct marketing salesperson. Well, I would be around, because I was running around so much, I would be around them and I'd be around some of the babies who were very ill, and I hold the babies. Well, it turns out that in my holding of the baby, which I knew was wrong at the time, but I was choosing to do it, I contracted a very rare disease. Let me share the story of what happened. I came home on Monday night. For some reason, I didn't have to go to classes that night. I came home around 5, and I was wearing my heels and my business suit. I gave everybody a kiss hello, and I decided to start cooking dinner. As I was cooking dinner, my husband came home, and he was standing next to me, and suddenly I felt like my knees were literally giving out. He said that I looked really, really pale, and that something was going wrong. And at that point, I said, I can't stand, and I started kind of falling to my knees. He helped me get upstairs and put me to bed and said, don't worry about the kids, he'll take care of it. And that was fine, and I slept during the night. In the morning, even though I had some big meetings, I just felt lousy. I really felt like every ounce of energy had drained from me. And I told David I'm staying home today. He gave me the phone and I called up my assistant Maggie and I said, Miggy, I just can't go to work today. I'm staying home. Just tell everybody that I'm out sick. And we rescheduled some of the appointments. I really wasn't my normal self when I was talking to her. I'm usually like really high energy and I was just kind of sick. You know, I was just saying I can't do it. Maggie hung up the phone and my husband called to see how I was doing and he was concerned with how I was sounding, but he had patience and he was at work and hung up the phone. When we hung up the phone from each other and I was lying there in bed, I knew something was really, really, really wrong. I couldn't move my feet to get out of bed. I mean, I tried. My mind was clear and I was saying, move your legs, move your legs, and I couldn't do it. I tried to get to move my hands and my arm. The phone was right next to me. I could see it. I couldn't move my head, but I could see it by my elbow. You know, when I was kind of moving my eyeballs down, I could see the phone and I couldn't reach it. I couldn't, my elbow, even though it was touching it, could not move. I just remembered lying there in bed and being really, really, really scared and frightened, and a tear started coming out of my eye along the side, and I just couldn't reach my arm up. I couldn't wipe my eyes. I was so scared, and I just kept on saying, please, please have somebody call me. Please come for help. Across town, my husband, who was a chiropractor at the time, had a very busy day filled with patients. And he was with them and moving along, and he had this real feeling like something was wrong at home. He told his secretary, cancel all patients, I'm going home. And he did, and when he came upstairs, my face was, he said, white as a sheet, that my mouth was starting to break out with these little white, like, pussy things. I know that sounds gross, but it was. And he picked me up and carried me down, put me into the car, and drove me to our doctor's that wasn't that far away. When we went to the doctor's, and I don't remember any of this, but the doctor said, we have to rush her to emergency. She's really ill. And they did. They rushed me to the hospital, and I was totally out of it. I don't remember anything for 3 days. I only remember coming out when the doctor was standing near my mom and my husband. My husband was on one side, my mom was on the other, and they told him and her that they didn't know if I was going to make it or not. I just remember seeing my mom crying when I started, like, fluttering my eyes, I guess, and came to. It turns out I contracted some really rare disease because some of the babies had their immune systems were just so low that they carried some of these diseases with them, and because my immune system, because I was running around so much, was low, I caught it from them. My doctor came in and he said, after I was starting to get better, after some medication that they gave me, he said, you know, you do have a choice. You do have the choice to be in the hospital or to go on a cruise. He says, it's a lot cheaper if you just relaxed on a cruise. It was one of the first times that I really learned or heard that I had the power of choice for the life that I wanted to lead. That I had the power to really decide the quality of my life. I'm confronting myself again with that quality. How about you? Do you look at the choices that you eat? Because I always have to look at my choices that I do. So, if we're looking at this being responsible, we have to understand that the power of choice comes from the word responsibility, which means the ability to respond to something. The power of choice is our ability to respond to requests, to what our head is telling us that we need to do, to what we imagine things are the rules. It is our ability to respond so that we have a full understanding that we are in control of the quality of our life. Some of you have heard me talk about the drama queen and drama king syndrome. The drama queen and king is someone who creates massive amounts of chaos around them so that they don't have to take responsibility for their choices. So they don't have to blame themselves for the ability to respond. They like to put all of the energies around them and blame everybody else that's around them. How about you? I know that I have definitely been the drama queen. I can actually see myself doing it. How about you? Do you notice when you start creating stories to cover up the actions that you took? Do you find yourself creating chaos around you when life isn't going the way that you want it to? And you create the chaos to try to control things without going back to the bottom line, which is you and your power of choice. It's funny when I watch and I don't watch them often, as I'm changing channels. You ever notice that in soap operas, there's always a crisis? There's always something going on and somebody's trying to manipulate something because they didn't like the choice that they made originally? We have to look that we're not living a soap opera. That we are not creating chaos in our lives so that nobody can confront us about the choices that we made. We have to understand that our ability to respond is our power as a human being. It's our ability to respond that creates our power. It's our power that makes us more able to have the life of our dreams. The more powerful you are in your ability to respond, the more choices you can make to live the life you want to live. Creating a life that works and choosing life that works. What does that mean? For us, there we were, living in this house that honestly was beautiful on the outside but was not where we wanted to live. Every winter time, we had these French glass windows that were the real French glass windows, and there would be these cold storms that would come through, flying through every little pane. No matter what we did, we were still cold. Every time the snow came, it would pile against the side of the house, and there'd be these cold drafts coming in. I don't like the cold. I don't like being in the cold. My son, who was growing, had a bedroom that was, well, it looked like a captain on a ship's room. A little bed with some built-in drawers. And he had to walk through my daughter's room to get out. It was not the best situation. At the same time, we were finding ourselves just tired of the cold. Tired of being in New York and wanting the warmth, the sun. So, within just a series of events that happened within a month, my husband sold his practice, we sold the house, and we decided to follow our dream and move to Florida. Now, there was a choice. We could have stayed. But we chose to go. What was amazing is that when we arrived, we reaped some rewards that we never, ever imagined. Because sometimes it's only by choosing that you actually get to reap some rewards. The rewards for us include two kids that are so happy. They love where they go to school, they love their friends, they love where they live, and they are very successful in what they do because we chose. My husband, who we did not know, had, well, we don't even know for sure if it's that disease, that when sunlight isn't around and you get grumpy all the time. We move down here. He's smiling all the time. Now, there was a choice that was good for us. For myself, coming down here meant living a life of dreams. I never imagined or I dreamt of, but to live in the sun all the time is just amazing to me. More importantly, for us all to be living together and me to be fulfilling to do having my business enables us to be here fulfills a part for me that was very important: to be powerful, to be a financial earner, to make sure that we can live a life of dreams. I love it, and more importantly, my family loves it. So together we're in this incredibly powerful unit. Individually, we are reaping the rewards of making a choice. Choose. That's the key of the game. Your choices totally affect the quality of your life. Let me say that again. Your choices affect the quality of your life. Look around you and notice that. Notice when you've made good choices and how that's affected you, and when you've not made the best choices and how that's affected you. The other thing that's important is understanding that little choices over time can give you huge results. Little choices over time can give you huge results. It doesn't take you to transform your whole lifestyle in order for you to be happy. It does require you to do one small little thing. Perhaps for you, it's that you do want to go back to school and get a new degree. You don't have to rush out and take all the classes at once, but you can begin small. There are so many opportunities for online classes that you could take a class to start out small. The other thing that you could do is start drinking water. If what you're not willing to do is give up the food, but you are willing to drink, start out by saying you're going to have a glass of water before you wake up, a glass when you first wake up, a glass after your breakfast, before lunch, during lunch, after lunch, before dinner, after dinner, and during dinner. When you do that, you're replenishing yourself and being energized and getting your body hydrated, which just makes you feel better. In other words, you made a small choice to reap some big results. The other part is that your hunger goes down. At least, that's the process and premise I'm working on now. Consistent choices make powerful results compounded. For instance, in our house, everybody does their own laundry. My kids do their laundry. My husband does the laundry. What we definitely have found out is once we made the decision that each of us was going to do the laundry when we first moved down here, each of us grew because of that. Because of the consistent choice of having clean clothing. For my children, let me start with my son. My son is 17. He does his laundry usually on Monday nights. What we definitely know is, one, that he has a built up his own self-esteem. He's amazed that his other friends don't know how to do the laundry, are shocked that he knows how to do the laundry, and have begun to call him up to ask for advice when they're in college about how to do the laundry. We found out that he takes much more ownership of his things because he's doing it, not me, not David. The same thing happens with my daughter. She's able to do her laundry, and she's learned over time that she doesn't like a messy room. My son's not quite there yet. So, on Sunday nights, she always does her own laundry, folds it, puts it away, and then she also makes sure that her room is exactly how she wants it, nice and neat. She too is walking around feeling more confident in herself. We have all had many conversations about how kids their age, 15 and 17, let their parents take care of them. They don't understand it. They just know that they can handle themselves and take care of themselves. It was a consistent change, consistent choice on our part to no longer do their laundry. But what's been the rewards we're all reaping is how everybody feels about themselves, including me, not being overwhelmed with having to do everybody's laundry. But how do you do that? And how do you know what choices will result in changes in your life? First, you have to really look at your life, your kids, and your romantic life. What do you like? What don't you like? And what would you really like to change? Once you've seen that, then you need to know, how can I choose to be differently in this? Maybe, just maybe, it's a little bit about just changing how you smile, or if you even do smile to that person. Maybe it's about understanding before you get out of bed to choose the kind of person that you want to be. I know for myself that I often, when I'm in a negative mode, am choosing that negative mode, that negative attitude, the negative angry stuff. And I can choose to stay with that, and trust me, I do sometimes. Or I can choose to change. And more often than not, that's what I'll do, is I'll choose to change so that I'm living better. Not for everybody else, but why should I be miserable walking around? Why should I be suffering by everything? In other words, how do you want your life to live? And then choose that. If what you want, if your kids are constantly putting out their hand and asking for money, and they're in the teen or maybe they're 10 years old, something like that, then you need to start giving them a budget and figuring out for them how it is that you want, how do you want them to live? Do you want them to be dependent on you for money? Or do you want them to learn how to budget themselves? I learned from a parent around here. Her daughter is given $100 a month. That covers what she's responsible for, the mother, for lunch for school. If the daughter wants any more money, she can go out to work. If she doesn't want to work, then she needs to know how to budget her money. We started implementing the same thing here, and once again, wow, were we surprised. Once we made the choice that we weren't going to be the bank every day, and that we were just going to supply the money that we were supposed to for their lunch and for their school activities, but everything else was their choice. So they can choose to either live with what was given them or to get out and get a job. Well, both of the kids have been working for a long time, but the choice was, it makes me feel better because I don't have to go struggling, wondering where changes to get for them to get to school during the day. The choice became, for me, that I can live in peace and relaxation and know that they're handled or not. Personally, I'll choose the first part. You need to know about and have some clarity about where you're going and what you want. Really look at every aspect, and you don't have to write it all down. Just notice it in the beginning. Then, if the choices you've been making aren't making you happy, choose again. And then be consistent about it. Peace comes because you're working on yourself. Peace comes because you're beginning to make choices that support you and the life that you want to live. So create a life that works. Know that your choices affect the quality of your life, that little choices over time can give you huge results. And making the same choices every day, being consistent, make those results compound. Your attitude. What is your attitude? Part is what you're feeling. The other part is what you're putting out there in the world. I mean, how are you presenting yourself? How are you talking? How are you thinking? And then how that all combines to become an attitude, We have attitudes of people who are just tired and whiny and all that stuff. And then we have the attitudes of, wow, hey, how are you? How's everything going? We have both kinds within ourselves. I am a crank. Yes, I admit it. I can get very cranky when it's my nap time or when it's nighttime before I go to bed. I get tired and I want to sleep and I don't want to hear about it from anybody and I get cranky. My family also laughs, though, because in an instant, if somebody calls from another part of the world and it's daytime for them, nighttime for me, I'll be cranky around them. I want to go to bed. I'm tired. I don't want to do anymore. And ring, ring, the phone rings, and there I am. Hi, how are you? How's everything going? And suddenly my attitude changes. I choose a different attitude. I do this throughout the day. I find myself sometimes feeling really low, and I need to change my attitude. Maybe I don't have time to just shut-eye for a little bit to get that energy back or go for a walk. So I had to internalize that and find a way for me to change my attitude, to choose to see the world differently. I remember driving one day on a beautiful road. Oh, there were trees, and it was sunny, and it was wonderful. And some of you may have heard the story that as I was driving, I was thinking in my head and kind of choosing all the negative things to think about. And suddenly it dawned on me, after all the years of studying about attitude, studying about human potential, learning about success and leadership traits, and reading constantly about having the ability to change the way you're thinking and to choose the way you're thinking, it dawned on me that it could just happen within a millisecond. As I was driving down there, I started truly playing a game with myself. Be negative, be positive, be negative, be positive, be negative, be positive, and changing my thoughts and ideas about myself instantaneously. I was having so much fun playing this game as I was realizing that every single part of the attitude piece was about choice. That I truly can choose to be anybody, anything that I want to be, if I have the right attitude, and that I am in control of my attitude. That was one of the most exciting, freeing days of my life, to really see that I am at choice. At choice of how I see the world and how I act and interact with the world. It was awesome. Now, why is it important? Well, this is important because it's like the key to unleash a lock. It's the key that can open your world to opportunities, to better relationships, to more effective sales. If you know that while you're in your car before you're going to make a sales call, that you have the opportunity to choose your attitude and say, today is the day I'm going to do that, and you walk out with a smile and your head up and your shoulders back and you're proud and you're confident because that's your attitude, then people respond to you that way. If when your child comes in and he's hurt and they're crying or they're feeling sad and you want to do something else, you don't want to deal with that right now. You know, and I know, that we've all changed our attitude in a minute looking at the child as they're crying, saying, oh, little one here, come let me hold you, and being sympathetic and quiet, even if right at the second before we were giggling and laughing. We can switch in a moment and have an attitude of compassion and empathy. No big deal. We just do it. We didn't even realize that we chose it. We need to know that we understand, you need to understand to have more effective relationships with people, you must be in control of your attitude. You must know that at any given point, you could change your attitude to be whatever it is that you want. Also, you need to know that when you're in a icky, nicky, yucky attitude, that you're choosing that. Nobody's making you feel that way except for yourself. When I saw that sign by Eleanor Roosevelt, when I was traveling around and I found this sign, and I got so angry when I saw it saying, no one can make you feel inferior without your consent. What was she talking about, I thought back then. Everybody can make me feel inferior. Everybody's in charge of that. They always want to put me down. Everything is about me being bad, bad, bad. That was an attitude that I had to get rid of. Took me a long time to realize, whoa, it's not them, it's me. I'm the one that tells that to me. I'm the one that believes that in me. I'm the one that's choosing to act that way. And if I'm acting that way, it's not working in my life. And it didn't. So that's why I learned, and I'm asking you, choose. Choose your attitude, but choose the right attitude. Choose the one that's going to be excited about life, that's going to be seeing the world going well, the one that's able to be compassionate with a child, the one that's able to be enthusiastic with your peers, the one that's able to say, if someone is treating you mistreating you, to choose to have the attitude of, I am not going to be taken advantage to. This is how I feel. And know that whatever anybody else is doing around you, that is your choice whether you want it to affect you or not. It's up to you to choose your attitude. Are you energized? Do you feel your heart pumping? Do you feel excited about life? It's a choice, you know. One of the things that I have found is that sometimes we choose the other part of being tired and anxious and just negative, rather than choosing to be energized and excited. And understanding that in order to do that, we also need to take care of ourselves to make sure that we are energized and are excited. I admit it. There have been times that many times that I won't exercise, that I just don't want to exercise. And when I started this business 7 years ago, I really spent years choosing not to exercise because I was busy. I needed to push the business and go and do this stuff. And I also found myself that as I started getting busier, it was hurting myself that I hadn't exercised. I found myself being on stage and something sounding like this. Even though I was trying to be as energetic as possible, but I wasn't giving you, the audience, everything that you needed from me, energy. So, when you want to be energetic and you want to have some energy, you need to do some certain things to create that energy. First is understanding that, yes, you need to do some exercise to create this energy. Walking. And then pushing yourself and walking or biking, anything that'll get your heart rate growing so that your heart as a muscle has the air and the oxygen so that you can move. Obviously, I am not a superstar in the physical body. But I do know that I need to take care of myself and I'm working on it more and more. But energy is also an attitude. Now, we spoke about attitude earlier, but what is energy? How is energy different than attitude? Energy is, for me, comes from the pit of our stomach, from our soul. It says that we were given this life source to create excitement about living. And I think that's what energy most is about, being excited about living, about what you do, about what you enjoy, and who you're around. Energy is a part of you that says, I like to move and I want to be happy and enthusiastic. The problem is I see more and more and more people losing their energy, who have given up the fun, who have given up the excitement about doing what they do. I go to more meetings and more presentations where I'm around people who are basically energy suckers than energy givers. I've been around tables where people are just silent and they're hoping that somebody will talk to them, but they'll never talk to anybody else, so they don't give and therefore they don't get. How many times have we been to presentations where people are so into themselves and so into their fears that they don't give us energy back to get excited about what they're talking about? deadly. It's deadly when we're doing that, because we're literally killing ourselves off little by little. Business places, the ones that are successful, are energetic and enthusiastic. When I walk into some businesses and I see everybody almost being deadly-like, I mean, the atmosphere is like silent and quiet, and there's nothing happening, and it's basically boring. I don't mean to be throwing around parties and being all excited, but you've got to have some energy and enthusiasm for what you do. Otherwise, why do I want to work with you? I pulled money out of a bank because every time I went in there, everybody was writing and looking at papers, and the tellers always seemed to be complaining or talking about somebody or something, but nobody was ever excited that I walked in as a customer. Nobody ever looked to each other as though they were happy to be there. It was a deadly, deadly place. And honestly, I didn't want my money there because, I don't know, it just didn't feel like my money would be prosperous and reach as many people as I wanted to. I just didn't think it would multiply as well in that place and someplace else. Energy is our life force. It's what makes us feel worthy and excited about getting things going. Think about the bosses that you've had. Those that were energetic and excited about what they do made you excited about what you were doing. How about in your house when that favorite uncle that has so much energy and is just so happy to be around you? Don't you get energy from being around him? Don't you feel full and then you become energetic about it? How about when you're around people who are of low energy? It sucks you, doesn't it? The life just goes out of you. It drains you. It makes it so hard to communicate to them. And when you're around someone that has high energy, it feels fun. You feel like you can share things and talk about things. And I'm not talking about that they're loud and they're enthusiastically, you know, clapping hands. They can be quiet people who are just exude happiness with what they do. So, choose to be energetic. We could talk about choosing our attitude and choosing our energy, but one of the critical pieces about choice is choosing to commit. While we can make choices and we could change those choices, in order to have the long-term effects of consistent positive choices, we need to stay consistent and keep them focused. Theodore Roosevelt, I think that had said it, or someone like that. I'm sorry that I don't have the exact quote. Make changes, make decisions quickly, but change them slowly. The same thing goes with your choices. Once you have evaluated the pros, the cons, and you've chosen, keep your choice there for a while. See what happens. If what you've made is a negative choice, of course, quickly change that one. Negative choices can impact us quickly because we end up beating ourselves up. But if you've made a choice, stick with it for a while. I think that it takes 31 days to change an action into a habit. So before you start your plan of action that's going to change, keep with it for about 31 days. Do it every day. Make that choice to stay on the same path and see what happens. Don't give up on yourself, because it's through your focused energy on your choices that you'll reap the results that you want in your life. Committing to yourself is one of the most powerful things you can do in your life. See, we often commit to our relationships. We commit to our jobs. We commit to our children when we have them. But how often do we commit to ourselves? How often do we truly commit to our own life, to doing what's good for us, to figuring out what will make our lives happy? It's not until sometimes we get terribly depressed that we begin to say, huh, I need to commit to myself. I need to make a choice here about what's good for me. We don't have to wait till that point. We don't have to wait until we get sick. We can actually do it from the very beginning, starting right this second, right now, to choose to commit to yourself, to live the life, the best life that you can possibly live, to truly know what does that mean to do and how do you do that, to figure out for yourself what choices have you made that didn't work, what choices did, and what do you need to continue along that way. The effects of a lack of commitment are that you'll begin to put yourself, you'll have that negative talk, that blah blah negative talk about how you weren't able to do it, how you weren't keeping up. See, your commitment doesn't mean anything. But that's not true. Your commitment has meant things to lots of people. You've committed to work. You've committed to your careers. You've committed to your children. You've committed to your friends and long-term relationships. So you do and are capable of commitment. It's just that oftentimes when it comes to us, ourselves, and what we want physically, emotionally, spiritually, intellectually, and fiscally, that we don't make the commitment, the necessary commitment, that'll actually reap up the rewards that we want to have. So choose to commit to yourself. You're worth it. There are some important parts about choosing. What is your, choose your attitude. Choose to create a life that works for you. Choosing to accept the responsibility and understanding the power of choice. You have to know that you need to have your attitude and choose your energy and choose to commit to yourself. Because that's the only way that you'll be able to take the action. And it's the action of the choices that makes the results happen. So know that the first step before you can take the action is to make the choice. And you have to know what you want from others, your life, your work, your family, and yourself. Without choosing and taking the action, you end up cutting yourself off to a life worthy of miracles, to a life that will fulfill you in ways unimaginable, to a life that will totally inspire you and others to live a life of dreams. Write me. Let me know how you're doing. And if we ever meet or our paths cross, introduce yourself. I love to hear from the people that listen and the people who help me be who I am.
For more products and information about Pegine and Team Pegine, please go to www.pegine.com. That's www.pegine.com or call 904-280-8806. That's 904-280-8806.